Welcome back for the second panel in the Residual Noise Conference at Brown University. I'm Ed Osborn, Associate Professor of Visual Art and Music. This afternoon's panel consists of two presentations by Marcel, Zaes and Clara, Latham, followed by a discussion among the three of us. Marcel, Zaes is an artist and artistic researcher whose work explores time grids in an interdisciplinary framework that encompasses its sociocultural backgrounds, its politics and perception, and the use of mechanical rhythm machines in music making, such as metronomes, drum machines, and step sequencers. Marcel develops defiant and deviant time algorithms that lie at the heart of his sound works, with which he critically explores rhythm as always relational and social. His work is regularly shown, performed, published, and discussed internationally. He has degrees from Bern University of the Arts and from Zurich University of the Arts, and is currently a PhD candidate in the Music and Multimedia Composition program at Brown University. He will present When Noise is Temporal, Drum Machine Histories Between Failure and Gain. Composer and musicologist Clara Latham's research and creative practice focuses on the relationship between sound, technology, sexuality, and the body. She has published articles in Sound Studies, Women in Music, Contemporary Modern European History, The Opera Quarterly, and the edited volume Sound, Music, Affect, Theorizing the Sonic Experience. She is currently working on a monograph that studies the shifts in listening, both to musical tones and to the voice that took place alongside the development of sound recording. Latham's opera about the birth of psychoanalysis, Birth of the Mom, was supported by the American Composers Forum and premiered at Roulette Intermedium in 2018. She is currently working on a collaboration with the dance company Ballets on an evening-length work of Gazelle of Loneliness that will premiere at the Joyce in June 2021. Before joining the faculty at the New School, Clara taught at MIT, Harvard, and Dartmouth. She is currently a fellow in sound and music at Akademie Schloss Solitude in Stuttgart, Germany. She will present Oral Interiors, Radio, Theremin, and Domestic Modernity.
Hi there, my name is Marcel Zaes and I'm an artist and artistic researcher and also a PhD candidate here at Brown in the Music and Multimedia Composition program. I'm working with and on sound and I'm mostly interested in the intersectional spaces that emerge when humans play with or against technology. My talk today is called When Noise is Temporal, Drum Machine Histories Between Failure and Gain. When Noise is Temporal, today I want to explore what we can find out when we think time through the lens of a grid in such a way like drum machines and metronomes do, by dividing time into mathematical periodic clicks that establish a sort of a background reference system against which any other potentially human temporal activity is then measured or also perceived. Today, I want to find out what happens when we think of this difference between a given background time grid and the foreground action as noise. That's what I call temporal noise today. I will first present a historical and probably by now also historic example of music, namely Sly Stone's song In Time, which is one of the first commercially available songs to prominently feature a drum machine and a human drummer. This example helps me to think about time grids as a larger cultural phenomenon. And then after that, I will talk about my own practice and I'll present a piece called Setting Number 27, a piece that deals with time grids in a very different way. It doesn't deal with time grids in a musical metrical sense like Sly Stone does, but it uses technology to produce mechanical sounds against which performers move in space. When Noise is Temporal, Sly and the Family Stone recorded the song In Time in 1973. It was a studio production that never was played live, at least not exactly as we hear it on the record. It's a studio production that Sly Stone created almost entirely by himself, I'm sorry. It's hard to imagine, at least for me, that in 1973 music was still primarily recorded as a band performance. But Sly Stone recorded music track by track, layer by layer, way before most other people did that. Miles Marshall Lewis, in his 2006 book There's a Riot Going On, describes how that might have happened, not only because Sly Stone was capable of playing all these instruments by himself, but also because he loved to work with drum machines. He would normally start out a song by recording the Maestro Rhythm King Mark II drum machine that played a beat and laid out the rhythmic foundation of the track. Then, layer by layer, he recorded all the other instruments and vocals, adding one instrument at a time. For this specific song here, he then hired session drummer Andy Newmark to play along, or perhaps against, both the rhythm, the drum machine, and the other already recorded voices. I'm now gonna play an extract of the song for you. What is special though is that he left both the Maestro Rhythm King and Newmark's performance on the final record. There are other tracks in which the drum machine only served as a first time keeper, later to be replaced by a human drummer. And then again other tracks, there never is a drummer recorded and the drum machine remains the only rhythmic foundation of the band. But here in the song In Time, we hear an emergent composite rhythm that is made of human and machine drummer the like. I did some in-detail analysis of microtiming in this song. I used the open source application Sonic Visualizer by Queen Mary University of London, along with the open source tools Vamp for rhythm onset detection, just to find out more about the time grid and the human deviance from that time grid. What I will play for you now is the onset detection algorithm that detects and then amplifies each onset, each rhythmic onset, with an additional percussive click. The algorithm here is definitely not perfect, and you'll hear that it will not catch every single little onset, but still I feel if you listen closely you'll hear how the human adds percussive impulses that sort of push and pull the rigid time grid of the drum machine. Newmark's beats seem to always reference a specific metrical moment, be it a backbeat, a downbeat, an offbeat, a 16th note, and so on. But they often pull or push the specific temporal grid so that momentarily they render the grid itself distorted. Or, in other words, we could say he momentarily challenges the periodic grid. So listening to this as either a skewed time grid or as a periodic time grid but with interference already points to the tension that is being set up here. And this is 1973. So in the years immediately following, we will see African-American disco music emerge and then house music in the queer African-American undergrounds of Chicago, where the drum machine becomes the rhythmic language of an entire genre, as well as a marginalized community that is fighting against white racism, both in their acceptance within a white dominated society as well as in the equally white dominated US music industry. I can see how the use of mechanical timekeepers amplifies a tension that might have been there before, but which ultimately leads to an even more segregated musical market and more tensions between black identifying and white identifying musical communities. But I want to pause here for a second and consider thinking about what happens here in terms of noise. So noise is not a term that I normally use in my research, but for today I'm interested in what we could actually gain from such thinking. Noise is a term that has a fascinating at least double meaning. It's being used as a technical term for a synthetic sound, namely that of white noise. But noise is also a colloquial synonym for sound that is considered faulty and must be avoided. Tara Rogers describes noise in her 2012 article Toward a Feminist Historiography of Electronic Music as an aesthetic category that poses the artistic material for some people while it is used to offend other people in their art making. Even just looking at these two book titles that Tara Rogers uses here, among others, brings to the fore this exact tension. Luigi Russolo claims the space of noise as art, while Trisha Rose, with her legendary first scholarly account on hip-hop called Black Noise, references how early hip-hop is perceived by outsiders. What is considered high art within a white male European avant-garde is a term for white people to refer to the music of African-American people in the South Bronx in the early 80s. Hip-hop, of course, contains a lot of noise, like all music does, in its technical sense as white noise, which is the source material heavily used by drum machines to actually synthesize the sound of snare drums and hi-hats and so on. But when the term noise is used with hip-hop, then it's regularly by white people who perceive hip-hop as a disturbance, a threat to their space, to their music, and hence as something that needs to be avoided. Now, to connect this back to Sly Stone, then we could apply noise as a term to think about how time grids are being understood. I don't mean that in the very sense of noise's two definitions that I just used, but more, I'm now really only using noise to refer to the time deviance to the regular time grid. So we could say that Andy Newmark, what he is doing in this song is he's skewing the time grid and he's playing with the time grid of the drum machine ultimately. But interestingly, as opposed to the avant-garde versus hip-hop tension that I explained before, here the focus is somewhat inversed. White people consider Chicago house, and that before it's being commercialized and normalized into white heterosexual European markets, as a not desirable noise. In part because it is almost exclusively made with mechanical time grids, and which exists sort of in a direct opposition to that which is seen as a virtuosic, expressive, tempo-free, and therefore real music, namely rock. In my exploratory definition of noise as a temporal deviation from a periodic mean, then house music would be perfectly noise-free, while rock would be overtly noisy. I think this is a fascinating realization because it shows how historically racism is not founded in the subject matter per se, or in the details or the specifics of the music of a community, but really it's just considering noisy that which comes out of a specific oppressed community. So, and whatever that might be, whatever they might come up with next. So let me now spend the remainder of this presentation with my own work. I want to show you a performance that has, at least at the surface, nothing to do with Sly Stone or with hip-hop or Chicago house music, but really is an experimental sound art performance that I made very recently during the pandemic this fall. Setting number 27 is a sound performance in which amateur performers use their phones as sound devices and carry mechanical sounds through an outdoor site that I call a found stage. With masks on and in social distance, they gather, then they follow the instructions I gave them, which only say that they should walk when they hear sound on their phones and they should stand still when there's silence. So each performer has a slightly different sound file that I made ahead of time for them. To make these sound files, I used a single 8-bit Nintendo Game Boy sound wave that is available on the web under a Creative Commons license today. And with a piece of pure data code, I built a drum machine that loops this very Game Boy sound very fast while it slightly alters the tempo. So in the resulting performance, we can hear the performers each listen to their own little drum machine sounds on their like played back on their phones. And we see them pace their walking and their steps, probably intuitively or also unconsciously, slower or faster, depending on what they hear and what others are doing. But we also see the compound emergent rhythm, and we hear, that is the composite of all performers walking and these many little drum machines playing at different paces, and which obviously also includes the accidental rhythms of the environment at the time of this site-specific performance. I'm gonna play for you an excerpt of the video documentation. Thinking of this performance now again using my ad hoc definition of noise as the temporal deviation from a mechanical reference system, then there's a lot of temporal noise here, at least in my own perception. I don't hear a main tempo or a grid to which others stand in reference, but it's more of a the only content I hear is the temporal deviation from some invisible and inaudible skewed and manifold time grid. But noise here in this performance is present in so many other ways. Akin to Sly Stone's In Time, where noise is not only the way in which a drummer relates to the drum machine, but in fact also the technical material with which the maestro Rhythm King drum machine generates its beats. Noise here is the wind blowing in the autumn leaves of Boston, where this is filmed. Noise is the sonic output of the traffic passing on the nearby street. Noise is the totality of all phones sounding together, and perhaps noise is also the emotional sensation in how the pandemic has made me feel awkward about performing as a group of people. Even though we're outdoors, we have masks on to prevent ourselves from COVID-19, but I'm still left with the sense of having lost all of my capabilities for social interaction in these past 6 months. But ultimately, noise here is really also the compound of all these mentioned sub-noises that remain for me from this performance. And as we performed setting numbers 27, we had a person, a stranger, slowly step up towards us. They waited until our performance was over, and then they started a conversation with us. And they said that they were both curious but also alarmed when they saw us entering their sort of post-industrial backside of a parking lot in Boston that we obviously also entered without prior permission. So they carefully asked us what was all this noise about. I'm closing my thoughts here for today, and I'm very aware of the fact that I posed more questions than I answered, but I'm really looking forward to the following conversation and to all the questions that might emerge from this. Thank you so much.
Hello, everyone. Thanks so much to Ed Osborn for inviting me, and thanks to all the other presenters. I am going to begin. As those of us gathered at this conference know, residual noise refers to the sound left on a tape recording after it has been erased. It can be considered evidence of what Mark Katz calls a phonographic effect, an impact of the technology of recording on what is being recorded. In fact, we could consider residual noise, defined as a sound that has a presence but is subject to some sort of erasure, as a defining aspect of sound recording, in the sense that in its nature as a reproduction, a sound recording is both a sonic presence, an iteration independent from the sonic event that is being reproduced, but the sound recording is also subject to the erasure that comes with its status as a copy, unglued from the temporality of the original sound. In the early days of sound recording, great effort was taken to resist such a distinction. Emily Thompson has argued that the tone tests pictured here, performed by the Edison Corporation, in which audiences were challenged to hear the difference between a phonographic recording and a live singer, were at the behest of proving that the phonograph produced real music, that it was just as legitimate as a live performance. I'll focus today on the relationship between electronic musical instruments and technologies of sound reproduction. While practical distinctions between technologies of sound reproduction and musical instruments are often irrelevant for musicians, the conceptual distinction persists, as Jonathan Stern has argued. Indeed, if the boundary between musical instruments and media of transmission or reproduction is in fact completely ruptured today, historical trajectories tend to distinguish electronic music and electronic musical instruments from technologies of sound reproduction. For example, histories of electronic music tend to focus on composers and inventors, while histories of sound reproduction and recording tend to focus on the cultural dissemination of recording devices. This distinction is made at the level of language. Sound reproduction refers to technologies like phonographs, wax cylinders, magnetic tapes, or MP3 files. Electronic music refers, on the other hand, to music that is created by electronic instruments, such as synthesizers, electric organs, drum machines, etc. While practically speaking, there are countless examples that breach this divide, the DJ turntabling, for example, the conceptual lines between technologies of sound reproduction and electronic musical instruments remain such that the turntable being used as a musical instrument is itself worthy of scholarly speculation. There are, of course, many instruments that defy such clear conceptual division. Microphones transduce acoustical signals, but don't necessarily constitute a copy. Similarly, radios send sound across great distances, but don't themselves capture or copy that sound. It is precisely these objects that sit in between technologies of sound reproduction and electronic music that I wish to focus on. I want to explore the relationship between electronic music and sound reproduction in order to ask if some electronic musical instruments are in fact more associated with reproduction, and therefore their residual noise rings louder. Thus, I'll propose a take on residual noise as a model for analyzing a particular electronic instrument, one of the first, which is the subject of my current research, the theremin. So let's begin with a short video of the inventor of the theremin playing the instrument. This will show the Russian scientist Lev Theremin, whose anglicized name became Leon Theremin after he moved to the United States. So Theremin invented the instrument while he was working in the Physico-Technical Instrument Institute under the Bolshevik Party in Russia in 1920. He created the instrument somewhat accidentally while he was working on models that involved using the human body as a kind of capacitance for electric signals. I'll play a short video of Lev Theremin playing the instrument a decade later. Okay, so as you can see, the instrument lacks a physical interface. The player's body controls the sound as if they were engaging haptically with an instrument. Their gestures correlate to changes in pitch and volume, yet what would be a vibrating string or column of air simply doesn't exist. The instrument appears invisible. So just to point out, we can clearly see situation for a conceptual fit for the concept of residual noise. We have a sonic presence that is also subject to a kind of erasure. The mode of interaction we find in the theremin presents a curious starting place for the history of electronic music, which is usually where it begins. For unlike synthesizers or samplers, the sort of stuff of electronic music we consider today, the theremin's production of sound doesn't involve a black box that produces sound by unknown means. Rather, a direct connection can be seen between the player's movements and the production of sound. Emily Dolan and Thomas Pattison argue that ethereal instruments like the theremin or the Aeolian harp both subvert and invoke agents and agency by drawing, quote, attention to their technological source while simultaneously subverting our ability to understand that source, unquote. Journalistic accounts of the instrument at its time of invention overwhelmingly focus on this magic-like ability to make musical tones out of thin air. Newspaper articles documenting the theremin's maiden voyage from Leningrad to New York fixated on the instrument's ability to produce sounds electronically, leading to speculation, and that's what I'll focus on for the rest of the talk, that this ability was going to perform musical labor that was previously performed by humans. So we'll move to some documentation from the journalistic accounts. You can't read this one, so I'll read it for you. One of these days, you will be able to pour out your soul in whatever melody happens to appeal to you at the moment, not through the severe, expensive, and laborious drudgery of learning to sing or play the violin or piano, but merely by standing in front of a box on your desk and waving your arms gracefully to and fro. Here are a couple others. These articles connect the absence of a physical instrument with a kind of musical freedom. What can be freer than the movement of hands in empty space to produce musical, beautiful sounds? Or there's this one talking about the commercial plans for the instrument. The promise of a musical freedom of expression is connected to the idea that playing the theremin didn't require any practice or any skill, any musical labor. We look at this line, never can the pianist or the violinist hope to attain the spontaneity of either the songbird or the opera prima donna, compares the theremin to the voice, which of course also has an invisible instrument. So while people were aware that the instrument used electricity, these accounts imagine it to provide musical expression that is somehow less mediated than a musical instrument. The theremin's association with a kind of natural, automatic musical expression that could be harnessed without any effort was heavily adopted in the marketing of the commercial version of the instrument by the Radio Corporation of America in 1929. So this is a press release about the RCA theremin, which was debuted at Madison Square Garden alongside radios that were also in production. And you can see the claim here that anyone who is able to hum a tune, sing, or whistle is likely to play the RCA theremin as well as a trained musician. And again, this is a brochure that was produced to advertise the instrument. And we see again and again the claim that the instrument gives the player this power to create music without skill. You can see here, having made the enjoyment of music universally possible through radio and phonograph, RCA takes another tremendous step, making possible not merely the enjoyment of other people's music, but the actual creation and performance of one's own music. I'm very interested in this rhetoric that the instrument was going to somehow save the labor of practicing, like the Hoover vacuum cleaner. For example, the theremin was marketed into this domestic sphere, an ornate piece of furniture like the phonograph. But the nature of the labor that this marketing is promising to save is not is a little bit different because it's musical labor. Okay. Excuse me. So this brochure produced in 1929 makes the connection between the claim that the theremin was easy to play and the idea that the music produced was an extension of the player's personality, distinguishing the theremin from the phonograph and the radio in terms of copy and original, as I already showed. You know, don't just recreate someone else's music, but make your own music. The brochure claims that it is precisely the lack of need for training that distinguishes the theremin from other instruments. Universalizing the desire for musical expression, the brochure distinguishes the music one makes with the theremin from what might be produced by a musician who had spent years in a practice room. While acknowledging the labor involved in practicing, the brochure at the same time promises to provide this labor for the exchange of $175, the cost of the instrument. So the context for this is, of course, a very rapidly changing audio culture, where musical listening is moving from a public to a domestic sphere, which partly explains the decision to market the theremins for the use in the home. And I'd like to look at some comparisons between the theremin and the instrument that it was ostensibly set out to replace, the piano. The marketing of the theremin to women for use in the domestic sphere aligns it with a kind of social labor performed by women that turns the results of biological reproduction into persons sufficiently socialized that they will work for capital. We see here an image of a child, being cared for by a mother or a governess of some sort. It says, you know, the highest musical authorities prefer the Sommer, and critics prefer the Sommer pianos. And then this has a quotation from New York Times, in which Theremin is predicting to that the instrument will be more popular than the piano. In December 1927, hopeful speculations that the theremin would take place of the piano are unsurprising given the piano's dominance in Western musical culture at the time of theremin's arrival in New York. In 1870, approximately 85,000 pianos were produced in Britain, the United States, France, and Germany. And by 1910, that number had grown to 600,000. The association between the theremin and the piano aligns it with techniques of gender performance that reproduce and maintain social norms for femininity. In her article, Girling at the Piano Parlor, Ruth Soley employs Judith Butler's term for the performance of gender as a strategy for maintaining social normativity to analyze gendered aspects of piano playing. Like many domestic practices, the phenomenon of girling is an example of unwaged labor that is explicitly linked to the domestic sphere. From a Marxist feminist perspective, this reproductive labor produces pure use value, but exists outside of the market. For many 19th century Victorian girls, piano playing was a form of social reproduction, providing entertainment for their families that was a form of emotional and affective labor. In her reproductive role, the female piano player can be seen to act mechanically, automatically producing affects in others via musical labor that is rendered invisible. Associations between femininity and mechanical reproduction harken back to Enlightenment era beliefs about the boundaries between humans and machines. Automata, like the female body piano players discussed in this book, presented Enlightenment era subjects with mechanical bodies. If the body was mechanically reproducible, as La Mettrie's L'Homme Machine argued, extending Descartes' argument about that animals are automatons, then bodies were no longer markers of the human, a site reserved for the mind. By promising that the theremin offers musical labor, the brochure also acknowledges the labor of female piano players who employed contraptions such as the Virgil clavier as a means of hiding that labor. I'm interested in the way that these marketing materials echoing the journalistic accounts seem to acknowledge musical labor while they also promise the labor will disappear if the consumer buys this new device. The claim that the theremin is the first non-mechanical musical instrument is explicitly connected to the claim that the instrument allows the performer to express something uniquely hers, her unconscious. We see this idea that the body is somehow joining with the machine to produce a kind of cyborg mechanism capable of creative production. I'll conclude here by returning to this distinction between sound reproduction and electronic music with which I began. The discourse I've analyzed suggests that theremin seems not to sit well on either side of this divide. While it is clearly described as an instrument, the insistence that the theremin can be played without the labor of practicing renders it more of a tool of sound reproduction. Of course, this was not actually the case. The disjunct between the advertised claim that the instrument was so easy to play and the reality, it's not easy to play at all, is perhaps part of the reason that the theremin was such a commercial flop. Here is the instruction manual that came with the theremin that's allegedly teaching you what's needed to play, but of course anyone who's actually played a theremin realizes it takes much more time to develop the technique than this might suggest. What resonates for me in this story of the first electronic musical instrument is this promise to save labor. Of course, we see this rhetoric in other commercialized electronic musical instruments. Gimmicks, as Sian Nye argues, always promise to save labor, to provide something for free. But it does seem that for the theremin, there is an acknowledgement of domestic musical labor, the laborious practice that the advertisers disdain. And not only labor, but reproductive labor in particular, and that it's taking place in the home, historically performed by women. My larger research question asks about the role of such gendered labor in electronic music more broadly. To return to the distinction between technologies of sound reproduction and electronic musical instruments, it would seem that a rethinking of reproduction is key to understanding the history of that distinction. One way forward might involve replacing a concept like sound reproduction with residual noise, as this conference has brought us together to think through. Thank you very much.
Oh, hey, Clara. So, thanks for your presentations. It's really a lot to consider there. And I guess I wanted to start with you, Clara, since you just presented the ideas are freshest. A couple of the ideas that seem to be underpinning some of your discussion, or thing that you reference in the discussion, of the sort of the placement, or the placement of the theremin, sort of as a cultural and musical icon, seemed to revolve around the idea of this kind of sort of magic ability to suddenly have musical knowledge, right? So that from our point of view today seems sort of comical. Here's this device, you will be a musician, right? And that you will have all this knowledge. And apart from the obvious idea that it, even if there's some sort of labor saving built into that process by using the theremin, that's not something you can get rid of. And I guess I wanted to ask first, was in the research that you've done around this and the discourse around it, has that come up in other ways? Because from what you presented, you could see that was an omission, but I can't imagine that was an omission, you know, for the sort of the whole history of the theremin. I can't hear you.
Yeah. How about now?
Yes, good.
Sorry. I don't know what happened there. For some reason, it's a different audio. Sorry, everyone. Good to be here. Could you just restate the last part of your question, the omission?
Just the idea of that this device the theremin will automatically imbue you with musical knowledge, that you don't have to bring anything to it. Did that idea get in the research you've done found evidence of sort of challenging that idea, or did that kind of carry through its kind of, you know, popular life?
Right. Okay. Thanks. That's a great question. I mean, I guess my first thought is as actually connecting it to the larger research question, which is that it seems that idea is kind of consistent with the marketing of electronic music. I mean, just as a capitalistic kind of promise, you know, it's gonna do some of the work for you. In terms of resistance, I've talked to a lot of theremin players, contemporary players, who are somewhat baffled by it because, of course, it's just, you know, it's not true. But one thing I find really, I guess, fascinating about the instrument is that at this moment that, you know, something's happening that you can't see, you know, the interaction, that's the kind of initial go-to. But I have found that there is resistance to that at the beginning. And then when the, you know, RCA and the inventor and his collaborators certainly really tried to push that idea. And that's where I guess I'm interested in the argument, going to kind of see how this plays out in other formations of sort of electronic musical instruments that are associated with this kind of, you know, giving you something for free, doing the work with you. I mean, and you know, you can make connections to even something like video games, or, you know, different kinds of software programs that have, you know, what is it about this
desire to kind of have the machine do something for free, which can kind of spread out in a lot of different directions.
Yeah, I was asking that because that it seems like a very relatively early idea of a kind of techno-utopianism, right? Here's the thing, magically it would be better. You don't have to the device will solve all those problems, like you say, labor saving, you don't have to learn the knowledge. And I mentioned it because a number of years ago, I had sort of the similar kind of conversation with someone who was sort of demoing some of the Todd Mack over at MIT developed all these hyper instruments a while back. And that was, it was basically, it was the exact same pitch, right? You'll be able to stand in front of this thing, wave your hands. You don't have to know anything about music. You don't have to spend hours and hours and years developing a technical, physical facility, and you'll get this like great result. I guess that's what, it seemed like it was a through line that was embodied very early in this, in the sort of the pitch around the theremin.
Yeah, I agree. And I mean, something that I didn't talk about in the talk, but that's very relevant to what you bring up with the concept of the techno-utopia is connections to kind of, discourses of machines being denied some kind of subjectivity, discourses relating to what kinds of subjects are in the human role and what kinds of processes of dehumanization are happening in specifically in terms of this notion that you're going to get free labor, so connections are made like with thinking of the work of Louis Trude Sakai or even Alexander Wahelier, talking about discourses of history of slavery and sort of the commodity that speaks. So those are some other kinds of things that I think in terms of what you bring up with the techno utopia that are very much at the heart of kind of my questions of what's at play here.
Right. Because it also, and just to follow along for one more and then we'll get
please,
to
yeah.
Marcel. We talked about in this conference the idea of the noise, that in that construction of the theremin being the sort of the repository of sort of musical expertise, that the noise, if we want to describe it that way today, would be in the body and the bodily performance, right? Which, as you know from playing the theremin, is hard to do and requires a lot of bodily skill. So I guess it brought me to the and this is where you come in, Marcel, that the idea of the bodily knowledge in terms of musical production, a musical experience, a musical expertise and performance, that if that is something that is defined as, or if we think of that as noise in some sense, in other words, a kind of deviation, that there's also an idea that that's where the the intelligence, for want of a better word, the sort of the spirit of the musical practice resides. And it seemed to me, and I mentioned this because both on the theremin, where you don't touch, you're literally not allowed to touch, that you're separating out in that construction, you're separating out the body from the production of the sound physically in some sense, because there's no touch, although it still requires that. And it's the same kind of construction that you have with the drum machine or the electronic machines, that the physical interaction is limited, the results are supposed to be of some form of a higher order, let's say, but in that space between the body and the device, there's noise introduced into that process, in other words, uncertainty. But in that uncertainty, there's kind of musical information, musical value. So I guess this is a way of maybe transitioning to you, Marcel, which is that we saw some of the same kinds of ideas that you were talking about in terms of the use of the drum machine, and in the one song from Sly Stone where there's a drummer playing along and we hear both of them. And that we hear that space between the two, as we as the piece progresses. And the thing that struck me was that the you could hear the kind of extra sort of swing that the real drummer, the musical performer, brought into the piece. And that in that space between that and the drum machine was kind of where the life of the song was. Like, in some sense, that was a kind of noise, that space, but it actually kind of made it, made the piece work. That was sort of what we would think about as the kind of groove of the piece. So I guess I wanted, if you wanted to talk about how that worked, if that formulation that I've laid out sort of makes sense for your estimation of how that works in that piece.
Yeah, sure. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. I thank you. Thank you, Ed and Clara. I'm also really just fascinated right now by thinking the drum machine in terms of what you just did, Clara, you know, in terms of an instrument between electronic music instrument and musical reproduction system, but also like where is it positioned between copy and original. And as you said, Ed, the bodily expertise that it takes to play it, the drum machine, and so Sly Stone was playing the drum machine, and then Andy Newark was playing the drums in this example. And I think I'm really interested in thinking about a sort of what I would say call a professional environment of commercial musical production in the 70s, and then when these machines, instruments, were advertised to home musicians, to amateurs, that then took them on. And so in my practice, I think I'm more and more just interested in taking these technologies and work with amateurs and see what happens in terms of expertise and bodily embodied knowledge in vis-a-vis these instruments. And I find that, I think this is also why I framed my talk today, not only temporal noise, which is something that I've never used before as a term, but also in this weird binary gain and failure. Also, of course, referencing Jack Halberstam's work, when failure is something that needs bodily experience and is a form of bodily knowledge, that is the failing as a cultural, as an artistic, as a cultural practice, that if you go through this process, then failure is a huge gain. And so I just in the way that these theremins were advertised, I still feel ultimately the saving labor part is the object of the ad, but then the ultimate aim is still to have, of course, technique and the practice and the sort of a professional practice that you can earn as an amateur, but still you have to go through this training and practice. Yeah, I'm wondering. I guess I'm answering the question that you had for me, Ed, which is a lot of questions for Clara.
That's okay. I mean, I think there are so many fascinating connections between our presentations. I mean, I haven't done, you know, work in that period, but I think that the questions of temporality and also of how you bring up failure is a real point of connection between our presentations, because I mean, I didn't talk a lot about it, but where I'm sort of going with this project is, you know, the theremin is a failure. All of this promise doesn't ever work in the way that it's promised that it will. But at the same time, as you bring up, you know, this kind of amateur bed, you know, what becomes more contemporary sense, like lo-fi kind of musical production, amateur production, of course, is a production, has uses, is work, you know, does things in the world, has utility. So there's another kind of way to kind of look at these, not just as a point of sort of failure, technologies separated out from their kind of cultural modes of circulation. I thought that was an interesting connection. I just think there's so much more to be thought of, both from like a perceptual angle that you bring up in terms of the kind of temporality of playing with the drum machine, but also just kind of what sorts of experiments were going on. I mean, in terms of, you know, Sly Stone and at the moment, I would love to know more about kind of, you said that he was one of the first people to kind of have both at once, but I mean, were there other, was that a really unusual thing to do at the time? Or, you know, I know some about sort of the history of, you know, these kinds of drum machines entering into popular music, but yeah, I think it's a fascinating question to see how those things sort of come together and move apart. So I don't have a question, but I'm sort of riffing off of what you were presenting.
Yeah, is it okay for me, Ed, to go on?
Yeah.
I think it's in 1971, I think, is actually his the prior album, There's a Riot Going On. That's the previous album, In Time is on the next album called Fresh. And the album There's a Riot Going On, I think it's interesting to see how a drum machine that is normally used in sort of band room contexts before and organ players using it for practicing at home and so on, is then become something that actually affords a popular music, if you will, that affords the track by track recording techniques that emerged just in the years with Sly Stone actually and others, of course. So this is what makes it special, that it's not only that, okay, now there's a machinic time grid and there's a human drummer. No, it's also, it's recorded track by track. And the time grid is what affords ultimately the recording of like layer by layer. And what is interesting with that is that really the time grid is the first layer to be recorded. And the drum, the Andy Newmark's performance is the last layer. It's not as we normally think that the sort of the groove section makes for the fundament of the song, that then the sort of, you know, brass or the vocals add to and react to. No, it's totally that every voice is sort of thought of separately, really.
Yeah. I guess one of the things when I think about that album, it's a riot going on, that I was slowly getting to was some of these questions, which is that I can't remember who it was, but someone described the song Family Affair that's on that album as the loneliest song about the family ever made. And you can hear it in the sort of the drum machine, and there were circumstances around that. Sly Stone himself was kind of isolated and for various reasons. But to me, the when you talk about, we're talking about these instruments that are supposed to be sort of aids or shortcuts, that one of the possible results of that is this kind of, you know, possibility for sort of either physical isolation or reduced interaction with other people, combined with the what appears to be the output of a group activity. And so in Marcel, in the project that you were showing where you had people in the space listening to these sounds and moving around, to me it looked like that was in some sense a sort of an odd embodiment of this idea that they're tuned into their sounds and they're doing the motions and they're sharing a space, but also fundamentally kind of isolated. They're operating independently.
Absolutely, yes. Yes, I was, when I heard Clara talk, I thought it's actually weird, because what I do as the organizer of this performance, I want to call myself the organizer, I'm calling together a group of amateur people who do this performance with me, who are not trained in the sense of this is not the phone is their instrument. They're not normally looking at their phone as an instrument. So they do not bring practice in the sense of instrument
playing knowledge to the performance. They also have no idea what is going to happen. And for me, it is exactly this sociality of the this very constructed moment of the performance is my key interest in addition to working with amateurs and in thinking about questions of access. Because I design instruments like the phones that need no prior knowledge, I'm then really, really interested in seeing and asking people after the fact what happened and what did that to them. And I do not tell them that I see these phones as instruments. I just give them a sound file and I tell them, okay, it's if it's playing, you're moving. If it's not playing, you're standing still. And basically everything else is up to their own interpretation. And so this is like a research space that I'm creating here for to see how people will ultimately engage with mechanical forms of time. And I think what is interesting here is really that the phone is only reproducing the file that I made. So it's a reproduction technology, but it's an instrument in that it has agency that ultimately guides their motion in space in the moment of the performance, to the extent that everybody's doing this in their own way, in their own interpretation. So, and they're all really different people who have done it in different places, and these places have a meaning. They're public spaces. We go there without permission. So there is a whole political side of that, and people think, look at us as a group and think we're protesting, and yet we are. This is a protest of some abstract or even not so abstract content or subject matter.
I just wanted to jump in. I think that's so fascinating, the relationship between the phone as a reproduction or copy, as you say, and that seems very connected to this idea of the grid, the mechanical temporality that this whole conference, the sort of conceptual organization, seems to be disrupting. And that was what I was most drawn to when I was thinking about what to put together, is, you know, that you see this, you know, in the instantiation of it, as your piece demonstrates, there's no such thing, right? For it to actually sound in the world, it has to have some kind of relationship between this copy, you know, unglued from its temporality, and this, you know, new instantiation. It's never going to be some kind of authentic, you know, purely mechanical thing. It's a fiction. So I really appreciated that manifestation of that conceptual clarity.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to follow up, I think time grids are so normalized by now. They're so programmed into our hardware and software, of course, but they're more than that. Like, they're not drum machines. They seem so old fashioned, the term. It's like drum machines, that's like a beatbox from the 70s or the 80s. But they're much more, time grids are much more everywhere as a sort of cultural logic through which we think music, perhaps much more than the air gestures that are necessary to play the theremin. Like, I might be wrong. I haven't done the research that you have done, but just really curious in like how normalized some of these gestures have become in these various histories.
Yeah, no, I think, I mean, I can speculate, but I actually think that there's something, you know, the theremin has this weird spot in the history of electronic music of, you know, it's always cited as this sort of first, you know, there's the Ondes Martineau, there are these others, but it's this big, big deal, it was such a big splash. And yet it's so different than many of the black box sort of formulations of synthesizers, even magnetic tape machines, that then become kind of the sort of ideological framework of how electronic music works, right? So I don't know, that's something that draws me to it. But I think that there's a relationship between, for example, your piece and also the sort of conceptual framework that you introduced, and this kind of, you know, the relationship, and this goes back to Ed's point, of the player with the machine as being one that is not spatialized temporally.
Yeah, I should add, anyone viewing this right now has a question for the panelists, you know, put it in the chat. We'll open it up. we're getting near the end of time, but I want to make sure that if there are questions that want to come in, that we can address them. I guess one of the things too that seemed apparent in the sort of the contrast between the theremin and the drum machine and the sort of interface, one was that the theremin still basically kind of exists in the way that it was presented initially, right? There hasn't been a huge amount of development of it, and we still understand, oh, that's a theremin sound. And, you know, it's somehow inherently a kind of musical sound. You know, when it's played well, it sounds, you know, like a violin or a voice, but it fits very well within a kind of musical syntax. With the drum machine and the kind of the, it seemed to point towards a later evolution where the physical interface of the drum machines were sort of limited. You know, like you could get drum machines that didn't have pads or anything like that that would sort of emulate that, but that pointed towards a form of now kind of musical and mechanical expertise that's embodied in software, you know, various sorts, where you can become a real expert sort of producer, player, performer using software in ways where the bodily interaction is very limited, but the musical expertise is quite large, right? So when you were talking, Marcel, I was sort of thinking about this in terms of you had presented the work with the drum machines and the grids as kind of like this middle space between the two. Like in some sense, it was a solution and sometimes a sort of problem in various ways. So I guess I wonder if you in the research that you've been doing, if you found other ways that had that aspect had kind of played out, where there was sort of bodily let's say bodily knowledge in relation to the usage of the drum machines, if that makes sense.
It does. Yes, I think also to be very honest is I you know, there's two things that I absolutely must and want to acknowledge, or at least one main thing is that there is a racialized component in all of this, that as I said, in a segregated musical market, these machines have different meanings in different communities. And so I was, as a white male, middle class European artist, maker, growing up with drum machines, I was heavily referencing, if not culturally appropriating, techniques from Black American communities without being aware as a, you know, as a teenager. And so I think much of my research today deals with actually sort of tracing my own story, and it's a huge acknowledgement. So that's just something I want to say, because I think it's important. It's an acknowledgement to Black American musics in plural, because I'm as I said, I was referencing many different communities such as hip hop, Chicago house, and techno, that were then much later normalized into European markets as what I have discovered them as, something like, you know, almost quintessentially European from the sort of 89 political movement of the Berlin Wall. And so when thinking machines, I can only think them and understand them through this new lens that I'm gaining with my research. And so this also means that I'm looking at very specific moments in music history that is not just like, when is it interesting that these two time grids overlap or are actually exhibited in one song? It's also when these racially segregated power structures of the industry play out. And so I just guess there's a ton of other songs where there is similar grid structures in the song. I was mainly looking at Chicago house tracks where there is a machine going and there is a second machine going that is not perfectly in sync. I just want to name perhaps groups like Underground Resistance, Detroit techno groups, where we're just like very, very interesting time grid things going on by the fact that two machines were basically synced in their macro time. So the loops of the step sequence was in sync, but not the inner steps. So it's like different amounts of shuffle and all of that. So there is a lot that I've been looking at in my research.
It seems like that's, if I could just jump in, it seems like a thread that's been across all of these presentations is kind of sort of a critical and, you know, a critical kind of interrogation of noise as an aesthetic and as a political sort of culturally engaged formulation. And just to respond to what you were saying, it seems like that's very much a through line of all of the talks. And I just wanted to say I found the first panel really engaging in that way.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think noise as a kind of a rupture, you know, and a sort of a, if not in between space, a kind of space that is somewhat, you know, adjacent or sort of ambiguously defined next to something that we know. So the space of the kind of musical practices that have been we've been talking about here and how they're enlarged by the instruments and then the way that we approach them. Mm-hmm. Those are good. I think we're about at time for this. So I want to thank you for your presentations and your really expert thoughts today, and invite everyone to the concert that's happening tonight online. It's at the Brown Arts Initiative's YouTube page. It'll be linked there and premieres at 8 o'clock.
Looking forward to it.
Yes.
Very much
so. Thank you. All right.
Thank you so much, Ed and Clara.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Ed. Great. Thank you.
Thank you,
Sean.